There must be a God, I believe it's true, 'cause I can see His love when I look at you. And He must have a plan for this crazy life, because He brought you here and placed you by my side. And I have never been so sure of anything before like I am in this moment here with you. Now for better or for worse, so much more than only words, and I pray every day will be the proof. Like a beating heart, I will live these words till death do us part. 'Cause I have never been so sure of anything before like I am in this moment here with you.
Doubter, like sight for the blind. your love shows me power from something divine.
Who gives Gracie to be married to Joaquin? Please be seated. First and foremost, on behalf of Joaquin and Gracie and the families, we would like to thank you for being here, to share in this moment, to share in this covenant, this promise, this union between Joaquin and Gracie. In saying that, Joaquin and Gracie, I want to have you guys turn around and just face the people in the audience. This is such a wonderful moment to sit back and just remember the impact and the influence that these people have had in your life. We can see in God's sovereign plan that he's brought these people to bring you to this place. You can see faces and people and relationships that have poured into you. And it's such a great day to just reminisce and remember what God has done to bring you to this point through these people. I think it's an amazing aspect of God's providence to use broken vessels to bring you guys to this point so we can sit back and just remember how good of a God that we serve is. In saying that as well, since you guys are here, there also is a challenge for you guys as well. You are here to celebrate this union between both Gracie and Joaquin. And God forbid there would be a day that they come to you with a struggle or a hardship in their relationship, but your duty is to point them back to each other. Your duty is to point them back to God. Your duty is to point them back to biblical truth. So in saying that, let's start with the ceremony. You guys can turn around. Let's start with the prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the privilege and the honor of coming here today to celebrate this beautiful union between Joaquin and Gracie, to celebrate your sovereign plan, Lord, your act of providence of bringing them to this day. God, we thank you for the fact that they can trust you in all things. They can look to you for what you desire of them to live a life of godliness as husband and wife. Lord, we thank you for the truth that you have revealed to us through your word. God, we thank you for the truth that you have revealed to us through your Son. We thank you that you have modeled true biblical love to us. And we just ask on behalf of the families, on behalf of everyone here, for the sake of Joaquin and Gracie, that their marriage would be one that is centered in you, centered in biblical truth, or that their marriage would be honoring and glorifying to your name. In Jesus' name, amen. As I said, I think it's a wonderful thing to sit back and just see God's sovereignty. We can see that God has a hand in everything. He is the king and he is in control of all things. And Psalm 115:3 says, our God is in the heavens. He does whatever he pleases. And in his sovereignty and his pleasing, he has chosen to bring you two for one another. I think that's a beautiful thing to reminisce and to just think about. Of all people in all time that are walking the face of this earth right now, he chose you and you for each other. And that's a beautiful thing to remember. And if God chose you for each other, then he must have a design and a purpose for you guys as well, right? And his design and his purpose is for you guys to glorify God. Man's chief end is to glorify God and enjoy him forever, right? So then the question is, how do I glorify God? How do you glorify God with your marriage? Will you do things his way, right? We praise God that he has revealed himself to us through his word, right? And as we're coming to celebrate this marriage, in a sense, it's also a funeral. It's a death of self, right? It's no longer I, but it's we. It's Gracie and Joaquin coming together to form a family by God's grace. So God's design is biblical love, and the foundation is important. And Psalm 127, verse 1 says, unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guards the city, the watchmen keep awake in vain. Foundation is hugely important, right? And we've talked about this in premarital counseling. Building your foundation on Christ and his word will be paramount for the success of your marriage. Marriage is built and protected by obedience to the word of God. And biblical love is defined in 1 Corinthians 13:4 through 8. And that's agape love. That's sacrificial love. That's selfless love. It's humble. It's willing. It's unconditional. It's not feeling. It's not emotions. It's a determined act of will or volition. It's a choice to love biblically. And 1 Corinthians 13:4-8 says, love is patient, love is kind, and is not jealous. Love does not brag and is not arrogant. It does not act unbecomingly. It does not seek its own, is not provoked, does not take into account a wrong suffered. It does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. That type of love is not feeling an emotion. That type of love is a specific and intentional choice, and you must choose to love each other that way. You put your name into that verse. You say, I, Joaquin, will be patient with you, Gracie. I, Joaquin, will be kind and not jealous. I, Joaquin, will love you and not brag or be arrogant. I will not act unbecomingly. I will not seek my own. I will not be provoked to anger. And you, Gracie, as well, can say, I do not take into account the wrong suffered. I, Gracie, will not rejoice in unrighteousness. I will rejoice with truth. I, Gracie, will bear all things, will believe all things, will hope all things, and endure in all things. And when we have that biblical understanding of true love, where we choose to do it this way, love never fails. Once again, that feeling is not an emotion. Love is not a feeling or emotion. There's no conditions. It says love is. Love is these things, right? To say I love you is to promise to do this before God, is to make that covenant to say, I will do this until death parts us. And this love is impossible in our own strength. It is impossible to do it on our own. We know that we are all sinners and we fall short of the glory of God. But with his help, all things are possible. So praise God. He's given us Jesus and his word to lead us and guide us. He's given us Jesus as the ultimate model of sacrificial love. No one gave up more for his people. No one condescended more than Christ for his people. No one was a more humble servant than Jesus, even to the point of death, death on a cross. Christ must be at the center of your marriage. You must have Christ and must love Christ more than each other. And that sounds different than what the world will say, but if you love Christ more, your spouse will get the best of you. When you do that, your spouse will receive the very best of you. The closer you draw to Christ, the greater your love will be for one another. It comes down to, do we trust really what the Bible says, right? Those who love me obey my commandments. So Joaquin, specifically, this starts with you. You must love her like it says in Ephesians 5:25, like Christ loves the church. And that's a tall order, and one that we know that we can't do in our own strength, right? There was a significant thing that happened down here when Mr. Schnur handed over her hand to you, right? He handed Gracie over to you, and she's a daughter of the king. She's been under Mr. Schnur's covering, protection, and authority up until this point. And when he placed her hand into your hand, he's saying, I'm entrusting this to you, right? That's a heavy burden. Now that covering, that protection, and that authority has been entrusted to you. And when you entrust something to someone, there's value in that, right? As it says in Ephesians 5, you are to sanctify her, to encourage her, and lead her in holy living. You are to wash her in the word. You are to nourish her, you are to cherish her, and ultimately, both figuratively and literally, be willing to lay down your life for her. She is not yours, she belongs to God. And the goal is to love her and present her spotless and blameless to the king. Matthew Henry has a great quote. Says, the woman was made of a rib out of the side of Adam, not out of his feet to be trampled upon by him, but out of his side to be equal with him, under his arm to be protected, and near to his heart to be loved. Joaquin, you are the head. You will be held accountable for her and your family. You are the leader. But in that, that's not a domineering type of leadership. It's not a controlling type of leadership. That's servant leadership. That's Christ-like leadership. You must love her like Christ loved the church. And Gracie, I'm going to tell you something that the world hates to hear, but you know the truth and you are more than willing to do it because we've had this conversation. The world will tell you this is weak. The world will tell you this is belittling. The world will tell you that this is beneath you. You know this. But Ephesians 5 says you are to be subject to your husband. You are to submit to him as unto the Lord. Because of your love for God and your love for Joaquin, you lovingly and willingly submit to Joaquin. And your willingness to submit to him is ultimately unto God. It's an act of obedience. It's not weak. It's not belittling. It's not beneath you. It's not about value. It's about order. It's about God's design. It's power under control. It's the willful, loving submission, that Christ-like living, right? It's the most Christ-like thing that you can do. And we must remember that Jesus submitted to the Father's plan of redemption. Jesus humbled himself to the point of death on a cross. So you must be content to be Christ-like. Let your marriage not make sense to the world, guys. Your marriage hopefully will not make sense to the world. You will die to yourself and no longer use the word I, but we. You will pursue Christ at all costs. You will forgive one another because you know what Christ has done for you and what you've been forgiven. You will love one another because Christ first loved you. And you will declare the gospel with your marriage to the world. And in saying that, you must remember each and every day, remind yourself of the gospel. Remind yourself of where you were outside of Christ, that he lived the life that you couldn't live and died in your place, right? But by his perfect life, he bore the wrath of God in your place as a substitute. And he rose again victoriously so you guys can have hope, right? So in those moments where it's hard, in the moments where it's difficult, and in those moments where you have those trials and tribulations, look to Christ, look to your redemption, look to the gift of mercy and grace that he has given you, and it will lead you and guide you into the end. And in saying that, we come to this point where we're talking about vows, right? Which is a promise, a covenant before our holy and righteous God. It is a promise you're making to one another, but ultimately you are making it to him. So if you then, Joaquin and Gracie, have freely and deliberately chosen each other as partners in marriage and know of no such clause by which you should not be so united, would you please join hands? Joaquin, in taking this woman you hold by the hands to be your lawful and wedded wife, before God and the witnesses present, do you promise to love her, to honor and cherish her in this life, and leaving all others, cleave only to her, and be to her in all things a true and faithful husband, so long as you both shall live? If so, please repeat after me. I, Joaquin.
Take you, Gracie.
To be my wedded wife. To have and to hold. From this day forward. For better or for worse. For richer or for poorer. In sickness and in health. To love and to cherish. Till death do us part. According to God's will. Joaquin, do you promise to do this? If so, please answer by saying, I do, with the help of God. Gracie, in taking the man that you hold by the hands to be your lawful and wedded husband, before God and the witnesses present, do you promise to love him, to honor and cherish him in this life and leaving all others, cleave only to him and be to him in all things a true and faithful wife, so long as you both shall live? If so, please repeat after me. I, Gracie.
Take you, Joaquin.
To be my wedded husband. To have and to hold. From this day forward. For better or for worse. For richer or for poorer. In sickness and in health. To love and to cherish. Till death do us part. According to God's will. Gracie, do you promise to do this? If so, please answer by saying, I do, with the help of God. Now you are each given to the other, for richer or poorer, for better, for worse, in sickness and in health, till death shall part you. Joaquin, what token do you give as a symbol of your love and faithfulness? As a ceaseless reminder of this hour and the vow you have taken, place this ring, the symbol of your love, on the hand of your bride and repeat after me. With this ring, I promise you my love. And all my worldly goods. With Christ at the center of our marriage. There is nothing that will ever divide us. Gracie, what token do you give as a symbol of your love and faithfulness? As a ceaseless reminder of this and the vow you have taken, place this ring, the symbol of your love, on the hand of your groom, and repeat after me. With this ring,
I promise you my love.
And all my worldly goods. With Christ at the center of our marriage,
There is nothing that will ever divide us.
For as much then as Joaquin and Gracie have come together according to the teachings of the Bible and the laws of the state of Idaho, I, as a minister of the gospel, declare that they are husband and wife. What therefore God has joined together, let no man separate. Joaquin and Gracie, I now declare that you are husband and wife. Joaquin, you may kiss your bride. May I present to you for the very first time, Mr. and Mrs. Joaquin Chavez.
Praise him in the morning, praise him in the evening. Praise him when you're smiling, praise him when you're breaking. Praise him in the sun and praise him in the starlight. Praise him every season, praise him through the dark times.
There will be a reception at 5 o'clock at the Best Western Convention Inn in Burley. So if you have questions, please see me or one of the family to get you directions on how to be there. But at 5 o'clock at the Best Western Convention Inn in Burley. So we'll see you all there. Thank you.
Heaven is a party, join the celebration. Come on everybody, time to start dancing.
Deja vu.
It's almost like you've been here before.
Did you get that phone call made? Good boy.
$60.
sunny see you there. Hi, Shirley. Hi there.
Hi. Oh, no.
Hi there.
I have a camera kind of like that.
No, you have one.
So I was going around taking pictures and videos of everybody.
Cheers! Cheers!
Already. Cheers. I'll even go like this. We'll get flip this around here like this and get man. Wait a minute. We got me and Tammy upside down. How do we get that? Ain't right.
That's gonna be one dizzy picture to watch there, Kelly.
Well, what the heck?
Is that for a church video?
I am now.
That's going to be a heck of a video, huh?
Wait, is that for a church
Jack?
Video?
Oh, where's the... There's the family over there. Yeah, there they are. We got to find the bride. The wedding, man.
Crazy video.
I just want to say thank you for being here. We're going to go ahead and start with the meal. So the way that this is going to work, Joaquin and Gracie will go first. You'll make your way towards the tables in the back. You'll start on the right-hand side nearest towards the wall. It's double-sided, so you'll just make your way this way, get your food, leave the dessert table alone for now. We'll do that with the cake. So get your food, and then you can come and have a seat. After Gracie and Joaquin, the bridal party will go, and then Gracie's family, our family, and then we'll continue with tables coming this way and then heading that way. I think that's it. Everybody enjoy your food. Go back to your pleasant conversations.
So now we're gonna have speeches. So we'll have the best man, Nico, do it first, then Sammy, and then we'll move on to Kate. Sound good?
All right. So as I was thinking about what to say today, I rewrote this 6 or 7 times just because there's so much that I can say about my little brother. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna give a little bit about our relationship and a few stories to go along to kind of paint a picture of who he is and what he is to me. So first, Joaquin and I are about 6 years apart in age. Sorry, before I continue, is there a way to turn down the speaker?
That's about me.
All right. So Joaquin and I are about 6 years apart in age. So I have my older brother, about 4 years older than me, then I have my little sister, about 4 years younger than me, another little sister, and then Joaquin. So when I was growing up, I was really competitive and I loved sports. I played all the sports. But I always found myself kind of doing things on my own. So I would be outside, I would throw the football up in the air and catch it. I'd be dribbling in the driveway playing basketball. We had a little concrete step. I would stand 5 feet away from it, chuck a baseball as hard as I could against it, and field it. Again, always on my own. Eventually, I had Joaquin, who was bold enough to come and do those things with me. Maybe not old enough, but he was bold enough. He had the courage to come and do it. So I have a little story that, as I was thinking about those times, it just reminded me. Same things. We would do these things, but we would do them together. So we'd be in the backyard, and we had two fences. I don't remember his age, but he was a little guy. and I put him full pads, and I wouldn't wear any pads, just to kind of make it even. And so what would happen, we'd be in the backyard, and we would take turns. I would say, okay, I'm going to punch you the football, you get it, you touch the fence, you score a touchdown. And then we'll switch, you can run the ball, and I'll tackle you. Or I'll run the ball, and he'll try to tackle me. And so I remember, again, a lot of my success in football actually came from him, because I wouldn't make him tackle me, he would just have to touch me. And so I would be juking him, all these different things. But I remember a particular day, I punted him the football, he was coming, and I laid into him. Boom! He hit the ground hard. I felt bad, but he got up, and he was like, all right, let's go again. So I did it again, I punted him the football, he was running around, almost got past me, boom, got me again. And it happened a few more times. Every time he got up and he was like, all right, let's go again, I'm going to get you. And it happened one other time, and I remember he got up, and he had tears in his eyes, but he wasn't crying, and he was like, all right, let's do it again. All right. So I did it again, and then I let him juke me and let him score a touchdown every time. But all that goes, again, just to speak to his toughness as a person that he's had since he was a little kid. To kind of go off of that story, along with the sports thing, to speak about a different side of him, I just want to talk about how he's always there. So again, whenever I was doing all these things, he would be right there with me. So now that I had a little buddy to go play with, we would walk across the train tracks and go to the baseball field, and we would do things together there. If we wanted to play basketball, we'd go to the elementary school, shoot hoops. If my mom didn't want us to run all the way over there, we would stand outside our driveway, we would pick a shingle on the roof and shoot basketball right into that shingle. Then my mom would get mad at us hitting the house, and so we would set up a garbage can and shoot a basketball into the garbage can. But he was always there. It didn't matter what it was going to be, he was there. Moving on, he was also just always around. So he was always doing those things with me, but then I expected to be on my own when I would go and do things with my team, or as I continued through sports. Turns out, he would just come to practice, and he would practice with the team. He would just be hanging out, and then people noticed, like, what is that little kid doing? Like, he's competing with you, so I don't know. But then, again, when the games came, then he would always create basketball games. He would always be creeping up. I'd look over, and he's on the bench with the players. I'm like, what? This guy's everywhere. Going all the way to high school. You would look at it, and he's a little kid, right? I look up from playing in a football game. He's a little kid in the student section with all the high school kids cheering for him. And all this, again, just goes to say that, you know, he was just always there. Not only for me, but as we'll see here in a second, everybody else that needs him. So last thing I kind of wanted to touch on just about him growing up were kind of some of his interests as he was growing up. So him as a little kid, little kids, as you know, they have all these different interests and they change so many times over time and as they grow up. For him, they change, but they're always kind of the same thing, which you'll see. At first, he was obsessed with cops. And which for a little Mexican boy, I don't know, it's an interesting choice. But no, he was always obsessed with it. Sheriff Kinnick's actually here. He was always talking about it. He wanted to do ride-alongs. He wanted to do all these things. From there, he was obsessed with the Army. He was like, I'm going to be an Army guy. He had little toy soldiers. He had all these things. He was interested in tanks. Some of my family members were in the military. He was obsessed with it. From that to being a fireman and the obsession with fire trucks, all these things. You look at him as he's grown up, as he's gone into high school and started to pick a career, he started doing some work as an EMT, and now he is looking at doing a career in counseling. And the thing that you notice about all these different professions is that they're all careers of service. And that's just who he is. And he's always been that person. And I think as Matt mentioned in his during the ceremony, that's something that you want to see in a husband. And he's always had that. So again, just his toughness, his dependability, he's always there, and his ability to be a servant. And so many other things that I haven't talked about that I could. There are so many stories for so many characteristics that he has that I could share, but it would take all night. And I like to think that when we were younger, he looked up to me, but all of these things that he encompasses, and many other things that I've strived to be as a person, that maybe I've come short of a few of these things, he encapsulates all of it. And I look up to him for it. Just for the man he is, and even as an older brother, I strive to be more of a man the way he is. And then, again, it's for all these things that as he gets married will make him, they've already made him a good man, but will make him a great husband, a great father. Gracie, I don't really quite have that much to say to you. So Gracie and Joaquin have actually came and visited Alexa and I in Virginia, and we've all hung out several of the times over the past couple of years. And the one thing that I always noticed, no matter the situation, you all probably noticed it during the wedding ceremony as well, is just the way that Gracie looks at Joaquin. And I've talked to Alexa about this too, and it's funny. So one, it's a little creepy. But in all honesty, it's actually, it's exactly the way that you would want your wife to look at you. So Gracie, I've seen the love that you have for him and that he has for you. You're kind, funny, you have a big heart, and I'm glad that Joaquin found you and he's going to be able to spend the rest of his life with a person like you. With that, I wish you both the best along this new journey, and I can't wait to be part of your life together. Cheers.
Gracie's brother, making her my sister-in-law. I'm very grateful for almost 5 years of being married to him and just being able to watch Gracie grow up a little bit. The last few years I have been able to watch her grow into the woman that she is today, from learning how to drive, getting her first job, going on mission trips together, moving overseas, going to Bible school, meeting Joaquin, and even them being able to visit us as well. I've been honored to be a listener and a witness of all the ways you've grown and how the Lord has worked in you in all these seasons. There's a few things I admire about Gracie. She is hardworking, a person of integrity, and a woman who seeks to live an upright and holy life. She is thoughtful and careful, and not one to make decisions lightly. I am confident that when Gracie said I do to her vows today, and to becoming Joaquin's wife, that's the decision that she's going to stand by. Joaquin, I've seen your willingness to love and sacrifice for Gracie since the first time I met you. Like when you visited us and you were willing to sleep on our family part before. the very first time. And visiting us in Iowa and just staying the night just to see her for a few hours. Gracie and Joaquin's relationship has exemplified the love of Christ, and I can witness to how you have sought to honor the Lord in everything you do. I pray you continue to only grow stronger in these things as you are helping them. Gracie, I love you. And I couldn't be more happy and proud of you and for both of you. And I'm very excited to have a book of our lives and see how we grow together. So that's all I got.
Thank you.
and I today. Thank you for all the love and support you guys have shown us through the bridal party this last week. And just all of you guys have been such a big part of my life and Gracie's this last week. And so I just want to thank you guys for that. And now we're going to move on to the cake. So we'll do our part. And then there's actually cheesecake in the back too. So if you guys want cheesecake, you can grab that after we cut ours. And our moms will cut the cake after us. And first come, first serve on that. Because there's not a lot. But, yeah. Can we get the music up?
It's going to be
cheesecake. They got cheesecake.